Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy. Displayed are the list of news articles selected for today's analysis and their page numbers in Chennai, Delhi, Bengaluru and Thiruvananthapuram editions of the newspaper. The link for the handwritten notes and the timestamping of the news articles are provided in the description box, and the timestamping for the benefit of smartphone users is being provided in the comment section. Now let us move on to the first news article. This news article is with reference to the update process in the state of Assam in the National Register of Citizens. The news article states that a guide has been published to check the names in the final NRC that is to be released in 2 days, that is on August 31, 2019. The news article also talks about supplementary list of inclusions or exclusion status. The article mentions that this list is for three category of persons. One set of persons who have submitted claims after the exclusion of their names in the final draft released on July 30, 2018. And this list will also contain the status of those persons against whom some objections were filed against the inclusions of their names in the final draft published on July 30, 2018. And this list will also give the status of those persons whose names were excluded through the additional draft exclusions list that was published on June 26, 2019. See, after the publication of final draft of NRC Assam that was carried out on 30th July 2018, this publication was followed by process of claims and objections. Those persons whose names were excluded, they claimed that they have to be included. And some persons felt that the names of certain persons are wrongly included, meaning so-and-so is an illegal immigrant, but his name is included, so I object the inclusion of his name. That is what we mean when we say objection. So this supplementary list will give the status of those persons who have submitted claims and those persons against whom there was some kind of objection. The news article mentions that the NRC was carried out in Assam in 1951. And we know that since 1947, Assam has been facing the problem of immigrants from the territory of East Pakistan. And this is because of partition of India and Pakistan. And way back in 1950, we had a legislation called as the Immigrants Expulsion from Assam Act of 1950. This law was enacted to protect the indigenous inhabitants of Assam. And if you see, since 1947 to 1971, there were large-scale migrations from East Pakistan to Assam. But from the day when Pakistan Army launched Operation Searchlight in then territory of East Pakistan and the present day Bangladesh, it was from this day huge number of illegal immigrants came from Bangladesh to the state of Assam. And that is one of the reason why any person who came to India on or after March 25, 1971 has to be detected and deported from India. And after this, in the year 1978-79, all Assam Student Union and few other indigenous organizations have found the names of large number of illegal immigrants in the electoral rolls. And they asked how the names of illegal immigrants who are not citizens of India, how can their names be included in the electoral rolls? From this moment, they started the anti-foreigners movement or Assam Andolan. And this movement started in 1979. It came to halt only in 1985 on the Independence Day of India with the signing of Assam Accord in the presence of then Prime Minister Mr. Rajiv Gandhi. This Assam Accord was signed between All Assam Student Union, All Assam Gana Sangram Parishad, the state government of Assam and the central government. This Assam Accord dealt with the foreigners' issue, about the safeguards and economic development of Indian citizens in Assam, and it also talked about other issues such as security in international border and about irregular issuance of Indian citizenship certificates, and also about restricting the acquisition of immovable property by foreigners. All these things were dealt with, and also it also talked about restoration of normalcy. That's why we said with the signing of Assam Accord, the anti-foreigners agitation came to a halt. In this Assam Accord, Clause 5 dealt exclusively with the foreigners issue. It said that foreigners have to be detected and their names have to be deleted from the electoral rolls and they have to be expelled from the Indian territory in accordance with law. This is one of the reasons why we say the present update process is also because of government's commitment to implement Assam Accord. But even after the signing of Assam Accord, there was no strong implementation of identifying the illegal immigrants or deporting them. And therefore, throughout the years, all Assam Student Union have been demanding the central government and the state governments to carry out the responsibilities as given in Assam Accord with respect to foreigners. And therefore, in 2005, they arrived at a tripartite meeting. This meeting was held between the Prime Minister of India, the state government of Assam, and the All Assam Student Union. Three parties. In this meeting, the state government of Assam has agreed to update the National Register of Citizens 1951. So that was the development in 2005. Even after this, there was no strong measures taken against the foreigners or the illegal immigrants. And as a result, the Assam Public Works, which is an NGO, has filed a writ petition in the Supreme Court in the year 2009. And following the orders of the Supreme Court, the state government of Assam has started the pilot projects to update NRC in two blocks in the state. However, because of law and order problems, these projects were stopped. And afterwards, in 2013, in the same petition filed by Assam Public Works NGO, the Supreme Court issued orders to carry out the update process in NRC. And as a result of the order in 2013, the state government of Assam has started updating NRC since 2015 by calling out applications. And this process, which began in 2015, in 2 days is going to end with the publication of final NRC for Assam. And one another news article states that the year 1971 cannot be the base year for determining the illegal immigrants. So they are saying that even though the state government publishes the updated NRC on August 31, this cannot be considered as a final updated NRC. This is because they are saying that the Supreme Court has not yet given its verdict on the petition filed by Assam Sanmilita Maga Sangha, which is an umbrella organization of several indigenous groups. So they are demanding that the cutoff year should be 1951. And there should not be any special consideration for illegal immigrants in the state of Assam. Because only for the state of Assam, the citizenship criteria extends till 24th March of 1971, which is not the case for any other state in India. So they claim the equality has to be maintained according to the constitutional provisions and also according to the Citizenship Act of 1955. So these are some of the information with respect to the analysis of these news articles. Now let's move on to next article. This news article discusses about the recent upgradation in the protection status for certain animals in the CITES International Agreement. During the analysis on August 9, we saw that India has proposed to upgrade the protection status of certain animals and also plants. And today's news article mentions that India's proposal has been approved by the concerned authorities and framework related to the CITES agreement. Now, CITES is the acronym for the Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species of Wild Fauna and Flora. It's not an organization, it is an international agreement. We know that thousands of plant and animal species are internationally traded and used by people in their daily lives for various purposes, maybe for food, for medicinal purposes, for housing. Housing is for plant species, and as tourist souvenirs, cosmetics, fashion, and for also as pets. But some aspects of the trade with respect to certain animals threaten their very survival. Countering this threat by regulating the international trade in these wild plant and animal species is the main ambition of the CITES agreement. CITES regulates international trade in around some 35,000 species of plants and animals, including their products and derivatives. Thereby, it ensures the survival of plant and animal species in the wild. This will ultimately result into protection of global environment, and it also gives benefits to the livelihood of local people. See, rural communities in certain parts of the world, they depend heavily on wild species of plants and animals for their livelihoods. There are two things with respect to this. One, say for example, they grow a certain plant variety and they earn money through it. And two, they grow a certain plant variety to that extent that the plant becomes threatened. So in such cases, the CITES framework promotes alternatives to such communities that will focus on conserving the threatened species by giving protection in trade, at the same time empowering the rural communities with alternative mechanisms. They may suggest some opportunities to go for other crops that may yield better money for the rural communities. And rural communities can also be used for conservation of endangered species of wild flora and fauna. And most of the rural communities that we here talk about will be of tribal population or indigenous communities. They depend on the ecosystem for wild flora and fauna species. And when this ecosystem is preserved, it is expected that that local population dependent on the ecosystem will have a sustainable livelihood. In some places, the local communities are also used for conservation activities and they are being paid for that. They are also used for community-based protection and they are also given salary allowances for that. These are also some kind of approaches that promotes livelihood of local communities. The agreement was signed in Washington, D.C. in the year 1973 and it entered into force in 1975. We already have seen in several our analysis that any country or a regional economic integration organization can be a party to this agreement. With respect to India's position, India has become party in 1976. Whether there is any regional economic integration organization in this agreement, yes, European Union is there. It has become a party under this agreement in 2015. So as of now, there are more than 180 parties. They say 183 parties. These parties to this convention meet together once in 3 years, A, B, C and 3. So they meet once in 3 years and the parties to this convention are called as Conference of Parties. For the last 3 days, we have been seeing about COP. First, we saw about COP of UNFCCC. Yesterday, we saw about COP of UNCCD. Today, we are seeing COP of sites. So the COP of sites meets once in 3 years. And the 18th meeting of Conference of Parties of sites happened at Geneva in Switzerland in this month till yesterday. It is in this COP 18, India's proposal for protection of certain species has been approved. Before entering into the news, we'll also see briefly about the three appendices under which sites regulate and protect the international trade in wild flora and fauna. Appendix 1 is the highest level of protection. It includes species that are threatened with extinction. Trade in these specimens are permitted only in exceptional circumstances. For example, scientific research. Permits has to be issued by the exporting and importing states and permits has to be issued only for scientific research. And in the case of a live animal or plant, the process of shipping has to take care of minimizing damage and ensuring health and preventing any cruel treatment. Coming to Appendix 2, this includes those species that are not necessarily threatened with extinction. However, trade in these species has to be controlled so that these species could be used in a compatible manner, not threatening the survival of these species. And Appendix 3 consists of the species that are protected in at least one country, and these countries would have asked other parties to the CITES convention to assist in controlling the trade in such specimens. On 9th August, we saw that India has proposed to CITES to upgrade the protection status of three animals from Appendix 2 to Appendix 1. They are star tortoises, the smooth-coated otter, small-clawed otters. These species are now listed under Appendix 1 of CITES after the 18th COP. So they will now enjoy the highest degree of protection in international trade as there will be a complete international ban enforced on their trade except certain circumstances. The news article has also mentioned the comments of the head of TRAFFIC India. See, TRAFFIC is a leading non-governmental organization that is working globally on trade in wild animals and plants in the context of biodiversity conservation and sustainable development. So it's a international wildlife trade monitoring network. Now let's see in brief some of the animals mentioned in the news article. First, let's see about star tortoise. Now the scientific name of star tortoise is Geocalani elegans. It's a medium-sized tortoise that can be found in India, Pakistan and Sri Lanka. And within India, it can be found in Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh and Odisha. And some of their present threats include illegal collection, loss of habitat, accidental deaths in road accidents And they are also kept as pets in many homes because they believe that they bring good luck and fortune by taking them from the wild and keeping it in their homes. And it is said that in terms of numbers, Indian star tortoise is the single most confiscated species of tortoises in the global illegal wildlife trade. It is said that 90% of trade of star tortoises occurs at part of the international pet market. Possessing this species as pet in India is illegal, and we have been seeing in newspapers of several cases being reported. With respect to protection under national legislation, that is Indian Wildlife Protection Act of 1972, star tortoises are placed under Schedule 4 of the WPA 1972. And in IUCN Red List, this species has been listed as vulnerable. And IUCN predicts that if the exploitation of star tortoises continue, there will be a decline of more than 30% of their numbers by the year 2025. That means by 2025, all the dependent organisms of star tortoises will also be threatened. So earlier it was placed in Appendix 2. There was only controlled trade. Now it is moved to Appendix 1 for better protection within CITES framework. Now let's see smooth-coated otter. Its scientific name is Lutrogale perspicillata. This otter type is found in India, Nepal, Pakistan, Bhutan, Iraq, and also in majority of Southeast Asian nations. Listed under Schedule 2 of WPA 1972, comes under vulnerable category in IUCN Red List. Now we'll see small clawed otters. Its scientific name is Anoix cinereus. This animal can be found in most of the Southeast Asian nations and South Asian nations. We can see it in India, Bangladesh, Bhutan, Nepal, China. It is protected under Schedule 1 of Wildlife Protection Act of 1972, listed as vulnerable in IUCN Red List. One side, they are facing loss of habitat. Their population is declining. On the other hand, these type of otters are traded internationally for their fur. Anyhow, both these otters have been upgraded from Appendix 2 to Appendix 1 in CITES agreement. One more animal is mentioned in news article, that is Tokay geckos. It is now included in Appendix 2 of CITES. So that means trade has to be controlled in this species so that the trade is compatible in a way that it does not threaten the survival of the species in the future. Gecko is a nocturnal and highly vocal lizard. Nocturnal means the lizard is active in night. The scientific name is Gecko gecko. They are classified as least concern under the IUCN Red List. It is reported that they are sold in the open in some South Asian countries for pet trade and also for medicinal purposes. But now the inclusion in CITES Appendix 2 will bring some control and restriction on the sale. So we saw about star tortoise, we saw about CITES, we saw about the three lists, we saw about smooth-coated otters, small-clawed otters, we also saw Tokay gecko. So these are some of the information with respect to the analysis of this news article. Now let's move on to next article. This news article talks about a recent statement made by the Speaker of the House of the People. He has said that a common code of conduct will be framed for legislative bodies in India. So generally when we say a code of conduct, it means it will have some collection of rules and regulations, and the relevant stakeholders to whom the code of conduct will be applicable are expected to follow the code. Say for example, we have model code of conduct for elections, and the electoral candidates and the people are expected to follow accordingly as mentioned in MCC with respect to elections. The news article talks about Commonwealth Parliamentary Association, India region, and that the Speaker, Lok Sabha Speaker, has presided over the meetings of the Executive Committee. This meeting was held in Parliament House in New Delhi. Now, the main purpose of introducing or framing a common code of conduct is to check interruptions caused by the members of the legislative bodies. Here, when we say legislative bodies, it includes lower house and upper house of parliament, that is Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. And in terms of states, it includes state legislative assembly and legislative council of all states. So who will be playing a very important role in framing this common code of conduct. The presiding officer of Lok Sabha has stated that a committee of presiding officers will be formed. Here, presiding officers means it includes Speaker of Lok Sabha, the Chairman of Rajya Sabha, and the Speakers of various state legislative assemblies, and the Chairman of the state legislative councils. By the end of this year, they will present their report based on which a common code of conduct will be developed. Now, if you come to Rajya Sabha or the Council of States, there is a code of conduct. This was introduced in Rajya Sabha in 2005. There are some 14 principles under this code of conduct which the members of Rajya Sabha are expected to follow. But if you come to Lok Sabha, there is no exclusive code of conduct similar to the one that is present in Rajya Sabha. But in Lok Sabha, there is rules of procedure and conduct of business in Lok Sabha. Under this, Rule 316 capital B describes the functions of the Committee on Ethics in Lok Sabha. One of the functions of this committee is to formulate a code of conduct for members and to suggest amendments or additions to the code of conduct from time to time. However, note that no code of conduct has been formulated for Lok Sabha till now. The news article mentions that there is a consensus among the presiding officers of legislative bodies in India to increase the number of sittings of legislative bodies and also to increase the productivity of legislative work. When we say legislative work, it includes discussion with respect to introduction of bills, statement and objects, whether there are any issues with respect to bills, any amendment required, any amendment not required, the positives and negatives, debates, and then passing of a concerned bill. All these things are included in the legislative work. And legislative bodies, say parliament or state legislatures, they are also called as representative institutions. These are called as representative institutions because the members are directly or indirectly elected and they represent the people in these institutions. The presiding officers have also agreed that there should not be disruptions or interruptions, and issues have to be constructively discussed and debated in the legislative bodies. Reports say that in the 16th Lok Sabha, around 16% of the scheduled time was lost due to disruptions. And in the case of 15th Lok Sabha, about 37% of the scheduled time was lost due to disruptions. And disruptions also cause delay in bringing policy or bringing a legislation, and also to conduct the normal business of the legislative body or the house. This will reflect in delay in providing welfare to the people, or it will also delay the governance reaching the people. Thus, it will affect the governance process. It will also lead to wastage to the public exchequer, and thereby the people's money is getting wasted. See, this is because, say for example, the house gathers for a day and a lot of money is spent to ensure proper conduct of business for a scheduled day. But say the house is disrupted and nothing happens constructive on the particular day, that means whatever resources spent has become a waste. That is one of the way in which disruptions lead to wastage to the public exchequer. Now, while there is discussions on there is increased interruptions, there is increased disruptions, we should also keep in mind when framing the code of conduct, the presiding officers of the particular committee has to keep in mind, it should also adequately talk about the time that has to be given for the opposition parties. See, opposition determines health of the democracy. Inclusive discussion is very important for our country where there are diverse populations, diverse communities. So the code of conduct should also have certain provisions with respect to having some ethical time frame for opposition parties to give its remarks during a debate or a discussion also. And there has to be one of the reasons that are mentioned with respect to disruptions or interruptions is that because of lack of ethical conduct among the elected members to the legislative bodies. The news article talks about the executive committee meeting of the Commonwealth Parliamentary Association of Indian Region. See, this Commonwealth Parliamentary Association is the voice of parliamentary democracy of the Commonwealth countries. That means members of the Commonwealth. When we say Commonwealth, it is also called as Commonwealth of Nations. During our daily analysis on 12th July, we discussed about Commonwealth of Nations, with respect to the matter of including Maldives again into this group. Now, the objective of Commonwealth Parliamentary Association is to promote rule of law and individual rights and freedoms, and also to pursue the ideals of parliamentary democracy. This association consists of around 185 entities, and these entities could be national level parliaments or subnational legislatures, which are also called as provincial assemblies or state legislative assemblies, etc. But these entities must be those entities from the members of the Commonwealth. At present, if you see, there are 53 countries that are members to the Commonwealth. The Commonwealth Parliamentary Association was originally established in the year 1911. At that time, it was called as Empire Parliamentary Association. This name was changed in the year 1948. The name was changed to Commonwealth Parliamentary Association. It consists of 9 regions. One of the region is India. The other regions are Africa, Asia, Australian region, British Islands and Mediterranean region, Canada, Caribbean, Americas and Atlantic, Pacific and Southeast Asia. The headquarters of the Commonwealth Parliamentary Association is located in London, United Kingdom. So these are some of the information with respect to the analysis of this news article. Now let's move on to next article. This news article talks about a new study commissioned by the central government to assess the microbial diversity along the entire length of River Ganga. It is also said that the study will test whether the stretches of the river contain certain microbes that promote antibiotic resistance. When we say antibiotic resistance, it means the resistance offered by bacteria to the antibacterial drugs. Therefore, antibiotic resistance is a kind of antimicrobial resistance. Here, the microbe is the bacteria. When there is antimicrobial resistance, it means that whatever the antimicrobial drug is given to the particular patient who is infected by a microbe, the microbe will adapt itself by taking certain modifications. Thereby, it will make the drug ineffective. This resistance is what we call as antimicrobial resistance. If the resistance is offered to antibiotics or antibacterial drugs, then it is called as antibiotic resistance. And those microorganisms that develop this resistance, antimicrobial resistance, are also referred as superbugs. And when we say antibiotics, and these are medicines that are used to prevent and also to treat bacterial infections. One or two example for bacterial infections could be diphtheria or tetanus or even syphilis. Now, coming to the commissioned project, it is expected that the project duration will be 2 years, and the project will be undertaken by scientists from Motilal Nehru Institute of Technology in Allahabad, which is a public institution, and the National Environmental Engineering Research Institute, shortly called as NERI, which is a research institute under CSIR, Council of Scientific and Industrial Research, and then Sardar Patel Institute of Science and Technology of Gorakhpur, along with 2 startup companies. It is said that the startup companies will provide genome sequencing services. The present study is also expected to involve mapping the genomes of microbes that are collected from the stretches of River Ganga. When we say genome of a particular organism, it will have the complete set of genes of the particular organism. Say, for example, genome of bacteria will have the all set of genes of a particular bacteria. The genes of an organism are made up of deoxyribonucleic acid, that is DNA. And when we say genome sequencing, it is about figuring out the order of DNA nucleotides or DNA bases in a particular genome. That is, what is the order or sequence of adenine, guanine, cytosine and thymine, the compounds that make up an organism's DNA. We said this study also involves mapping the genomes. A genome map actually helps the scientist to navigate around genome. It is a set of important information that will give information about genes, DNA sequences. It is said that it is less detailed than genome sequencing. A genome map is less detailed than genome sequencing. A genome map will give the location of genes and also the distance between genes. Now, the objectives of this research project or this new study is to indicate the type of contamination in River Ganga. And while attempting to study this, the research project will study the contribution of wastes from sewage collection and from industries, whether the wastes are released into the river after the treatment or before treatment. All these things will be studied. The study will also indicate the level of threat to human health because of the contamination of the river. This threat to human health has to be read with the antibiotic resistance. While attempting to research about this threat, they will also identify the sources of bacteria E. coli or Escherichia coli. See, this is a type of bacteria that lives in the stomach of animals and humans. The word gut is used to represent stomach or belly. These bacteria are largely harmless, but some species of E. coli have been linked to intestinal diseases and also for aggravating antibiotic resistance, thereby becoming a threat for human health. So in that case, if these species offer some resistance, then whatever medication we give to the particular patient, it will be made ineffective. One speciality with respect to the new study is that there have been several studies, but these studies have looked at the microbial diversity in isolated stretches, whereas our new study will be conducted throughout the entire stretch of River Ganga to the length of around 2,500 kilometers. Some of the previous researches that were conducted along Ganga has said that the superbugs increase heavily during the pilgrimage months of May and June than in any other time of the year. One of the reasons is because of mass bathing in Ganga during these months, the time at which some of the antibiotics are released into water. And one another reason could be disposal of medical wastes. Somehow the antimicrobes or antimicrobial drugs come into contact with the bacteria that are already present in the river. In other cases, the antibiotics used in humans and animals are actually not completely broken down, so they eventually pass through the body and they enter the environment as waste. And if this environment is a river environment, they will interact with the bacteria that are already present there. So that bacteria will modify itself in its environment and develop the resistance to the antibacterial drug. Once the resistance is developed, the resistance can be passed from one bacterium to another. Now, when people take baths or dips in the river as part of their pilgrim activities, the resistant bacteria enters human body and obviously it will lead to bacterial infections. But these infections cannot be treated with the existing drugs, because these drugs will be made ineffective because of the resistance. So therefore, the study aims to assess the microbial diversity and the contribution to the threats for human health. So these are some of the information with respect to the analysis of this news article. Now let's move on to next article. This news article discusses about werewolf syndrome, is also called as hypertrichosis. It's a very rare condition. Hyper means more. Trichosis means any abnormal condition of hair or any disease of hair. Hypertrichosis is excessive hair growth or too much hair growth. It can happen anywhere on the body for both male and female. Hypertrichosis can be classified based on the distribution in the body, or it is also classified based on age of onset. In terms of distribution, if the condition is present throughout the body, it is called as generalized hypertrichosis. If it occurs only in a particular region of the body, it is called as localized hypertrichosis. If the condition is present since birth, then the condition is called as congenital hypertrichosis. If it is acquired, it is called as acquired hypertrichosis. The news article talks about acquired condition only. We will see that. And this condition is also classified based on type of hair that grows on the body. Vellus hypertrichosis or terminal hypertrichosis. Vellus hair means thin, short hair. Terminal hair means long, thick hair. A news article states that at least 17 children developed werewolf syndrome in Spain, as reported by the Health Ministry of Spain. Now, this issue has happened because of a major medicine mix-up. See, children were given the wrong drug. Children were admitted for gastric reflux. Gastric reflux is the burning sensation in the chest and a sensation where one feels that contents in the stomach are in the throat. So the apt drug or the right drug to cure gastric reflux or to treat gastric reflux would be omeprazole. But instead of giving this drug, they gave a drug that contained minoxidil. Now this minoxidil ingredient that is used for increasing the growth of hair or used for the treatment of hair loss. And because of this wrong treatment, the parents started noticing hair growth in children. And the problem here is some of the children were babies. And because of this, the condition has occurred all over the body for some children because of administering wrong drugs. And therefore, it is called as acquired generalized hypertrichosis. Now, it is called as werewolf syndrome because of abundance hair growth. These are some of the information with respect to this news article. Now, let's see a few practice questions. Now, this question is with reference to CITES convention. They have given three statements and are asking which of the above statements are correct. First statement, the Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species of Wild Fauna and Flora is an international agreement to regulate the international trade of plants and animals, including their products and derivatives, to ensure their survival in the wild. Now, this statement is correct. Now, the second statement, India is not a party to this agreement. Now, we saw that India has been a party to this convention since 1976, after the agreement came into force in 1975. So, the second statement is incorrect here. India is a party to this agreement or this convention. Third statement, once the second statement is wrong, we can eliminate option B and option D, and this increases our probability of attempting the correct answer to 50%. Now, the third statement, Appendix 1 includes species threatened with extinction, and the trade in specimens of these species is permitted only in exceptional circumstances. As discussed, the first and third statements are correct. Therefore, option C is the correct answer. Which of the following animals are classified as vulnerable under the International Union for Conservation of Nature? Red list of threatened species. Star tortoise, smooth-coated otter, small-clawed otter, and tokay gecko. During the analysis, we saw that the first three animals are now protected under Appendix 1 of CITES Convention, as the 18th conference of the parties to CITES Convention recently approved India's proposal for better protection of these three animals, star tortoise, smooth-coated otter, and small-clawed otter. And all these three animals are also listed as vulnerable in IUCN Red List. Tokay gecko has been listed as least concern. So therefore, fourth point should not be there in options. So we can eliminate option C and D. So the correct answer for this question is option B, 1, 2, and 3 only. Now, this question is with reference to Commonwealth Parliamentary Association. They have given two statements asking which of the above statements are not correct. Now, the first statement, it is a voice of the parliamentary democracy across the world. See, Commonwealth Parliamentary Association is the voice of parliamentary democracy across the Commonwealth countries. So, the first statement is incorrect, not across the world. Now, the second statement, the objective of the Commonwealth Parliamentary Association is to promote rule of law and individual rights and freedoms, and also to pursue the ideals of parliamentary democracy. Now, this statement is correct. So, the incorrect statement is first statement. Therefore, option A becomes correct answer. Now, this question is with reference to werewolf syndrome. We saw this news article with reference to few kids in Spain getting affected by this syndrome because of medicine mix-up or because of wrong treatment of gastric reflux. We saw that this syndrome is also called as hypertrichosis, which refers to excessive hair growth. So therefore, the correct answer for this question is option D, a medical condition that causes excessive hair growth in the human body. So the correct answer is option D. With this, we have come to the end of our today's news analysis. If you like the video, press the like button, comment, share, and subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for daily updates and content on civil service exam preparation.